Welcome back. Our panel is here. Joshua Johnson, he's former host now of 1A on NPR, also an NBC News contributor, and actually soon to be a bigger part of the NBC News family. Kara Schwisser is co-founder and editor-at-large of Recode, tech news and analysis website, also the author of a growingly popular column in the New York Times. Susan Glasser, a staff writer at The New Yorker, and Matthew Continetti, resident fellow at the American Enterprise Institute. Good to have you all. Kara, I want to start in your world of tech, because the one thing we haven't touched on as much is sort of social media. We talked about it on the sides, but sort of the role social media is playing right in this misinformation campaign. Mark Zuckerberg and Jack Dorsey are kind of having a debate. First, let me play a clip from Mark Zuckerberg at Georgetown a couple months ago.
While I certainly worry about an erosion of truth, I don't think most people want to live in a world where you can only post things that tech companies judge to be 100% true.
Jack Dorsey, head of Twitter, actually seemed to disagree with him. This isn't about free expression. This is about paying for reach. And paying to increase the reach of political speech has significant ramification that today's democratic infrastructure may not be prepared to handle.
Yes. Well, that's the two sides of it. And then Google sits in the middle and it's trying to figure out a way between them. You know, Mark's idea is he's conflating free speech with paid speech. And it's purposely confusing to people. Anybody can say anything on their platforms. It's on Twitter, for example. Donald Trump continues to tweet, as you noticed this week, perhaps. But his campaign doesn't get to do paid advertising. And that's a very different thing. What's really interesting is that balkanization has been around forever.
Sure.
And early, you know, you look at George Washington, all those days, that was very partisan crowds on every bit of media. The issue is when you get it into the social media space, it becomes three things. It becomes weaponized, it becomes amplified, and it becomes anonymous. And then you can repeat lies, and then they take a virality and create engagement that leads to enragement. And then, it do it again. Lather, rinse, repeat. And that's what goes on.
This to me is, look, this is not new. I mean, Lyndon Johnson is always credited with saying, I don't know if it's true or not, just say it and make them deny it. So the idea of disinformation, but social media just makes it where the space between what's first reported and the fake part almost has gotten
It's
reversed.
Faster. Yeah. It's amplified. You have to think of amplified and weaponization of it because it repeats and repeats itself and it's not controllable in a different way.
I do think, though, that social media, what you just described about engagement and enragement, which is very true, exposes part of the problem and maybe part of the solution for those of us who consider ourselves journalists. I think one of the issues that I have with the way we're fighting back against this is we're trying to fight back with information, but journalists are not in the information business. We are in the trust business. Trust is an emotion. You compete head to head. You connect heart to heart. And the enragement speaks to the fact that people are seeing information that provokes an emotional response. Well, trust is emotional too. It's like love. You don't remember when you fell in love necessarily. You don't remember when you decided to trust journalism necessarily. But that emotion is broken. And I think part of what we have to do is acknowledge that there is a heart piece of this, that people are trusting these lies and this misinformation. And a lot of them are just damn lies. But they work. They give you comfort. They make you feel like the world hasn't changed in ways you don't understand. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't mean we affirm the lie. It doesn't mean we don't speak the truth. But if we're ignoring the human part of this, none of what we're doing is going to work.
Matthew, he's getting at what I wanted you to tease out here, which is almost it's the cultural connection that the right has decided it doesn't have with mainstream media. So it doesn't matter what we report. Well, you don't understand my life, so why should I care?
Right, and that cultural disconnect is decades old.
Sure.
What gives us this perfect storm of alt-truth is a few things. One is you have the technological change, which Kara mentions. Another is you have the institutional breakdown, which I think you showed earlier in the program. Confidence in these big institutions is just totally
fake. Thank God for Congress, or
and then,
we'd be
and then,
at the bottom.
And what makes it, then you have President Trump, right, who kind of plugs into benefits from both of those changes, but also uses it to amplify his message. And so what you end up with is this place where no one can really agree on the very basic material governing our democracy.
Mm-hmm. I think the important thing, though, is to recognize that this just didn't organically happen. This also comes in the context of a war on the institution of independent journalism, a war on the notion of truth that has served the political interests of you know, institutions in the country. I mean, I think Fox News has waged a purposeful campaign over decades to convince people that other people's news wasn't the correct news. In fact, that they were the only purveyors of correct information.
This goes back to Alexander Hamilton, though. It's sort of discrediting publishers. And
But, you know, look, we have the president of the United States who says that the media is the enemy of the people. I'm not familiar with any president who's ever spoken in this way, who has waged, as Marty pointed out in your mm-hmm. first interview, I think importantly so, this was a political strategy. There is a calculated campaign going on that there's the result of what's here. Now, there's also new tools and, you know, a whole human nature element of this, but it's very important not to let people off the hook. Partially, we're seeing Russian propaganda make its way into American politics because Russia has paid money and has made that a focus of its efforts.
But here's the thing. They lost the Cold War. They've won this one. And what I get the emotion part.
You're in past tense. They've won.
They continue to do it. It's not a battle. We're not fighting against it in the proper ways by just the Ukraine thing. It's ridiculous. It's very clear. This is a lie. CrowdStrike is in California. I've been there. Trust me, they're Americans who are running it.
Right, so, and now you have the president of the United States amplifying
that. Yes, but it's a lie. But what it is it's algorithmic. I get the heart part, but you're being targeted. But this paid advertising is targeted.
That's
it is
true.
Exactly right. And so they can whisper 1,000 different lies in 1,000,000 different ears. And so that's what the difference is. And so it isn't heart. You can't get to the heart because they amplify and algorithmically, technically get it so that you can't find the truth.
Matthew, I want you to address what I think is an ecosystem problem, at least on the right. I want to put up something that my colleague Ben Collins put here. It's a bit of an ecosystem here. He'll say, you'll get something starts on 4chan, there's the subreddit of Trump, InfoWars might pick it up. Then it starts inching into the mainstream. Gateway Pundit might just say, oh, what's this about? Then it gets to Drudge, might have a provocative headline link. Rush might say it in his fun little way. Then it does make its way into Fox News, and then, of course, your Facebook feed. How do you create more accountability in the conservative ecosystem for basically dealing with propaganda?
Well, it's hard work. I mean, I think it begins by trying to instruct young conservatives in the canons of journalism, mainly empirical verification, right? And this, I think, the distrust of institutions that's longstanding among conservatives has led many of them to no longer believe in the idea that you need kind of evidence in order to forward a fact, or they don't believe in certain verified sources, mm-hmm. credentialed sources of evidence or information. They don't trust any of it. One other change that I think makes all of this more difficult is it used to be you can go to the supermarket and you see the tabloids and you see the Weekly World News mm-hmm. and the alien has predicted who's going to be the president this year, and you move past it.
Right.
Maybe some people get a chuckle, maybe some people believe it, but it's a minority of the population. Today, you can't ignore it because it's everywhere. And the second that you go on one of these platforms, social media in particular, you're confronted by it.
I still think, though, I hear you in terms of the distrust among conservatives of institutions. You're right about that. I do, however, know a lot of conservatives who are God-fearing people and who remember that the Bible says that it's better to tie a millstone around your neck than to lead one of my little ones astray. They know that Bible verse that says, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. They've read the book of Proverbs, and they know the first two chapters are all about the value of truth and wisdom. So I think that there's a part in conservatism that speaks to the value of truth and the necessity of personal responsibility. I think it is crazy that there are people who say, oh, it's just too hard. There's so much going on out there. There's so much information.
Yes.
We won a world war against the Nazis where we invented a new bomb and planted victory gardens and put women in factories. You mean to tell me you won't subscribe to your local paper? Really?
Is
this too hard?
Well, it goes to what is the responsibility of the citizen here?
Don't be gullible.
Yeah. No.
Don't make room for gullibility
anymore. It's impossible to fight it. It's addictive.
Yeah.
It's repetitive, it is propaganda, and it is in ways they don't even have to.
I feel like I'm watching the head and the heart debate
here.
I don't
mind
that.
But
the algorithm is strong.
It is absolutely strong. You're getting, it is doing things in ways that has never been possible through a newspaper. By the way, nobody is reading newspapers and shouldn't be. This is great to be able to get this information on your phone. And with conservatives, you know, there's a great book by Andrew Marantz called Antisocial that showed this chain. You don't even need the chain anymore. It's just Rudy Giuliani saying, they actually lie, like Kennedy on your thing list. It's just a lie.
Well, there's no penalty.
There's no
bother. That's the issue. There's no penalty.
Straight to it, and then it gets repeated.
Beyond a no penalty, there's actually an incentive. I mean, this ecosystem is so well embedded now in how one party is communicating with its core people that it's a chain that works. That I agree with Kara. I think not only can you not break it, but their design, their goal is to get people to say, I don't care. Not even necessarily to say, I believe this lie. Their goal is not necessarily to persuade the unpersuadable that Ukraine intervened in the 2016 election. Their goal is to get people to say, I don't know. I can't figure it out. And I think when you think about the 2020 election, and we are talking, at the very end of 2019, this is going to be the major driver, really, in politics. When you think about persuading people who tilted this last election in 2016, a handful of people, arguably, who might have voted for Barack Obama and then somehow also for Donald Trump, people who aren't necessarily living in the information world that we are. And I fear that group of voters is the group of voters who are saying, I can't possibly think of objective truth.
But this is also a political tactic, Matthew. I mean, we are now aware that there are some politicians who want to come on this show because they're hoping to get a viral moment to use for fundraising. Mm-hmm. Right. The minute we've caught wind of that, we won't put those folks on. And it's sort of like, yeah, it's fun to get chastised by the mainstream media. I mean, this is the...
Well, this has a lot to do in the change of the nature of institutions. You know, mm-hmm. You used to join an institution to be molded by it, to be a part of it, to be part of this kind of history that preceded you and will antedate you, or will rather go after you. Now, institutions are platforms for individuals. And this is what makes, this is the reason why the platforms are now the locus of so much attention, mm-hmm. whether it's media attention, cultural attention, or government attention, right? They're the new sites of political and regulatory battles because they are the guardrails. The social media knocked down all the other guardrails, right? But now the platforms themselves are the guardrails, and now they're going to be the heart of our politics for the next decade.
And they're unregulated.
Yeah.
A purist libertarian society, we're seeing the perils of it, Joshua?
I will say, though, there are a few things that give me hope. One is young people.
Yep.
I think young people are increasingly savvy to
Absolutely.
The very things
yep.
you're talking about. They've decided that yep. there are certain social media they can trust more than others.
Yep.
And the other is just the fact that I got to say, in 3 years of hosting 1A, yep. the one thing that's never failed
yep.
is telling our audience, if you let this conversation devolve into stupidity, the nation will turn you off, and there's nothing I can do to bring them back. Personal
well,
responsibility
there you go.
Does work.
There's nothing wrong with that. That is all we have for today's special broadcast.